is going on, everyone? So I just recently posted my film reveal video for my spring trip. And I'm always fascinated with the process of that, where there's an initial reaction we have to our own work. We might love it, we might hate it, we might be kind of ambivalent towards it, but that perception will change with time. And that's why I record those film reveal videos. I mean, partially it's a kind of a learning tool, so you guys can kind of see thoughts on composition and some more of the backstory behind what went into the photos. But it's really also for myself, so I can look back at those videos and kind of see where I've come with my work and kind of see how the perception changes and how I feel differently about those photos with time. Because there's usually a photo that I'm really looking forward to, one that I have really high hopes for. But, you know, over time that might just kind of fall away and turn out that that really wasn't the standout photo for the trip. There might also be some photos where I don't quite know what to think about them when I'm looking at them for the first time, but they turn out to be the strongest of the photos I shot on the trip. So that's the part that has always really fascinated with me, and this trip was really no different. So in this video, what I'm gonna do is I'm going to go through the various photos I shot on the trip, kind of share some more thoughts about them, because it has been 3 months since I went on that trip now. And the film reveal video was filmed in early May, right when I got back from the trip. So the memory of the trip was still really fresh in my mind, and some of that has faded now, and my perception with those photos has sort of changed with time. And there's some photos that didn't quite make it into the video journals, mostly because it wasn't really an important part of the story, or it's just not a photo that I really liked all that much. So in this video, I will kind of share some of those photos as well and kind of share my thoughts as to why those photos didn't work and maybe what I'll do different next time, because I definitely look forward to heading back to that canyon again. Maybe even in the fall, we'll see, but definitely next spring, because there's a lot more potential there. But let's start by looking at the first photo, which is one that I did not share in the video journals, and we'll talk about why. So this is the negative of the first photo that I shot on the trip, and this is a photo that didn't make it into the video journals. I did scan it, I just couldn't really get it to look quite the way I wanted to. Partially because I think the lighting of the scene wasn't quite ideal, the composition wasn't quite ideal. I had some good elements I was working with. There's the curved desert varnish on the right side, and then you have this kind of the cool looking clump of trees on the left side. And there's a little bit of a pathway that kind of leads into the photo, but it's not as compelling as I was hoping. I was hoping that it'd be a scene that'd be really inviting, that you'd kind of want to walk into, because that's kind of how it felt when I was there. But some things just don't really translate really well into a photo. I had a really hard time with the color of this and trying to make it look natural. Sometimes it's really hard to work with color negative film for shots like this, because it has a tendency to kind of go in a different direction than you want it to. It just isn't as cohesive as I wanted, but sometimes there's really that first photo you gotta shoot on a trip, which is kind of like the psychological barrier. Once you get that first photo out of the way, then you start kind of get on a roll to find other subjects. But with this particular composition, I do like the way that the curved desert varnish is on the right side. I was trying to figure out kind of how to move the camera left and right, how much to include on the left side versus the right side. I kind of found something that kind of works, but also I think you have sort of competing sides, the right side versus the left side. They don't really tie in together. They don't really integrate together. And in a perfect world, I would love to have it where there's kind of a brighter area kind of off in the background, kind of along where that path is. And that would kind of draw your eye into it. But instead, it's the upper left corner that's kind of bright area. So I think it just kind of ended up becoming a little bit of a mess, but it's always good to shoot the photo and then kind of question things a little bit after the fact. So the next photo I shot was that really cool looking cottonwood tree that's located right at the bend of a canyon. And this is a tree that I found the previous year, and I love the form of that tree, and I was determined to find a way to photograph that tree this year. And though I did take a photo of it, I didn't share it in the video journals. It turned out okay, but I think I can do even better. I'm not convinced that I had the best possible light on the scene. I checked out the scene in the morning. I checked it out kind of in the late afternoon. And this photo was taken on the second day of my trip, and this was kind of a mid-afternoon. What was happening is the light was kind of backlighting the tree, a little bit of direct sunlight was hitting the floor of the wash, and then there was some light kind of bouncing around in the canyon. And what's happening is that there was some light bouncing off the canyon wall kind of off to my right. And that was sending a lot of light kind of into the foreground where there's this overhanging wall on the left side that was catching a lot of light. And it was really picking up a really strong glow. And that kind of bugged me a little bit because your eye is attracted to bright areas in a photo. And that was kind of stealing some of the thunder away from the tree in the background. And even though the tree had some nice light on it, I had to really kind of burn down that wall on the left side. And by kind of looking at the video that I shot of different times of the day of this tree, I'm thinking that maybe the morning might be the best as far as having it where the background part of the composition is a little bit brighter than the wall on the left side, which I think would build more depth. But I also think it's kind of interesting to photograph this tree when I did, because the backlighting kind of gives it, well, it makes it stand out a little bit from the background. And it also has some light reflecting onto the trunk. So it turned out pretty decent, but I'm still a little undecided on this shot, whether I like it or whether I don't like it, because I think it's one of those shots that I can do even better with. Now, when it comes to the composition, you notice that the left side of the tree is chopped off by the wall there. And that's kind of was a necessity as far as trying to find just the angle to show, because that area actually was overhanging quite a ways. If I used a wide angle, if I got closer, I could show the entire tree, but it would have been a horizontal composition. And I think a vertical kind of suited it pretty well. But I think that actually worked out pretty well because there's also some kind of marks on the sandstone, kind of the overhanging ledge on the left side where it kind of continues the shape of the tree. But the composition I think works pretty well. I think the lighting's okay, but I definitely think it's one that I can do even better with next year. And also it'll be interesting because I have a slightly wider angle normal lens that I can try to shoot that with next year and see if I can find a time of day when I get even better light on it. And I think it might be the morning. So I didn't include this one in the video just because I think it's kind of a work in progress, but I think there's a lot of potential for this scene. So next up is the photo of that sort of cool looking tortured cottonwood tree that's in the canyon there, kind of right alongside the wash. And when I first saw this tree, I was sort of walking down the wash. I kind of saw it from the side. It kind of caught my attention because it was in really beautiful light. And it had kind of a cool looking character to it. But then when I kind of walked around to the front of it, then I saw it had like this really nice shape to it. And I knew right away that there was potential with this scene. So I used my 300 millimeter lens. I kind of backed up about as far as I could up against the other side of the wash and set up a composition. And I was just sort of trying to make sure I had enough room above the tree, at the bottom of the composition, and kind of balance the left and the right. And I think I did the absolute best that I could given the lens that I had. But when I look at this photo, I do wish I had a little bit more room on the bottom, a little more room on the top, and a little more breathing room on the sides. And mostly because this scene has this absolutely beautiful wall in the background. And I wouldn't mind having a little bit more of that. So I did recently purchase a Fuji 240mm lens. It's a slightly wider angle lens than the 300mm lens I used to take this photo. And I'm thinking maybe on a future trip, I'm going to try setting up the 240 and see if I can get a little bit more of that wall. But the other thing too is it could be that the 240 might be a little bit too wide, because I also have to be kind of up a little bit on the slope on the other side of the wash in order to kind of see over the top of some of the saplings and stuff that are kind of growing within that wash. So it's a scene I will revisit on a future trip to see how the 240 does. But I think I did the best that I could given the focal length that I had. And I had really nice lighting, the conditions really cooperated. And this is a shot I'm very, very happy with, but we'll see what happens on future years when I revisit this scene. So the next photo was the Harry Potter scar fracture in the rock. And that's a scene that I kind of stumbled upon as I was walking up the canyon the next day. And there was this kind of boulder field where you have to kind of like scramble over these big rocks that had fallen down into the canyon. And there's one point where I couldn't really get up over these rocks with my trekking poles, so I just kind of collapsed them, tossed them up over the top so I can get to them once I got over the rocks, and kind of made my way up on my arms and legs to get over these rocks. And then once I got there, I picked up my poles and Started to extend them out again so I can start walking up the canyon more, and kind of glanced over my left and I saw this really cool looking fracture, kind of really low on the wash on the left side. And it just had that really, really cool, clean look to it. And it's the sort of scene where I knew right away that there was potential there. And actually I said out loud, well, that's pretty cool. And then I dropped my pack, put the poles down and kind of started looking a little closer and saw, yeah, you know, this is gonna be a pretty cool shot because the light was gonna be good for probably another 20 to 30 minutes because then the sun was gonna shift and direct sunlight was gonna flood in the scene. So I set up the camera, normal lens. My goal was just to center the crack. And when I was looking at it on the ground glass, I had it perfectly centered. But what happens is there's kind of an area on the left side where it's kind of cut in a little bit where it kind of zigs and zigs back. And that particular area made it look a little bit off center. So I actually had to crop off a little bit off the right side, a little bit off the bottom. And when I showed this sheet of film to my wife, she said, I think it'd be even cooler if you didn't have those like the little pebbles and the sand and stuff on the bottom. But I intentionally included that because I think it gives a little bit more of a sense of scale. And it gives you a little bit more bearing as far as what you're looking at. Just know that it's something that's vertical as opposed to something that's, you know, down on the ground and you're looking straight down at. But I also like the way that some of the sort of tan colors and sort of the bluish colors of those pebbles helps to balance out the oranges of the sandstone. And also ties into the rocks that are kind of embedded within the crack itself. So this is one where I knew right away that there was some good potential there, and thankfully I made all the right decisions. The photo is tack sharp. If you zoom all the way and you can see the sand within the sandstone, which is pretty cool. And this is probably my favorite shot from the trip. There's some other ones too that are pretty cool, but this is one where I felt like I made all the right decisions. And if I can go back in time, I'd do the exact same thing all over again. So I was pretty happy with that one. So yeah, it was kind of cool how that one worked out. So next up was the photo that I shot as I was walking back out of the canyon. And there's this cool scene where the wash kind of curved to the right ahead of me. And there's this really cool looking sandstone, light bouncing around in there. And the floor of the wash had these white rocks, which is kind of cool because it contrasted against kind of the darker walls. And it looked really, really cool to the eye. I liked the way that there was light kind of further down around the corner of the wash, which kind of really gives the photo a little more depth, makes you want to walk into the scene. And I quickly set up a photo, but I had to use my normal lens, and the normal lens on an 8x10 camera is a 300 millimeter lens. Depth of field is a major issue if you use a lens like that, if you have such a confined space. So I focused about a third of the way into the scene. I stopped down at f45. I just couldn't get enough depth of field for it. But that's just fine because now that I look at the scene, even if it was sharp enough, I just don't think it really has the sort of look that I was hoping to capture. Maybe it was a matter of me maybe I should have used a wider angle lens or something along those lines, both to help with depth of field, but also maybe it add a little more depth to scene by including some more foreground or something else along those lines. But this is a photo that I actually had some pretty high hopes for before seeing the film. But now I know that it just didn't really turn out all that well. But the scene I found after that was really cool. It had it's a vertical photo. It had the really nice looking kind of reddish yellow streaks of desert varnish, reflected light. There's a green bush up against it with some kind of dry grass in the foreground. And when I did the film reveal video, part of the bottom of the frame was obstructed. And I was trying to kind of figure out what it was. And I've since figured out exactly what it was. It was actually the bellows of the camera that was getting in the way. And so I have my Intrepid here set up in a very similar fashion. So I was using a vertical orientation there. I had a little bit of front rise, maybe about an inch of front rise. And the reason for this is so that instead of aiming the camera upward and looking at a big wall, I can keep the camera a little bit more level, but move the lens upward, which allows the camera to kind of look up, but without tilting the camera up. So my goal was to try to keep those vertical lines nice and straight and vertical. But what happens with just a very modest amount of front rise with a vertical composition, the bellows right here are actually gonna get in the way of the shot. Even if I push it up, It never really fully gets out of the way. And this is something that I wasn't really used to dealing with because on my Ebony camera and also on my Arca Swiss, the bellows are fairly wide, kind of near the back, near the rear standard here. And as a result, it's a lot more forgiving. So I didn't even know to look out for this when I was setting up the photo. And it's tricky because when you view the image on the ground glass, you don't really see the effect of the bellows chopping it off because you're typically looking through you're looking at the image on the ground glass when the aperture is all the way wide open, and the obstructions can get really, really fuzzy. So since it's upside down when you view it on here, this is going to be the top, this is going to be the bottom, and it'll look just fine. But if I would have stopped the lens down to f45 and looked at it at the shooting aperture, I would have seen it obstructed right there. So just part of the learning process, and something to make note of if I'm ever doing a similar sort of photo in the future. Make sure I stop it down to my shooting aperture, take a look at the ground glass before assuming that everything's gonna be just fine. That photo is actually just fine. I could have cropped the bottom of it and I could make it perfectly useful. But that being said, it's a scene where I really wanted to do even better with it and nail it perfectly straight out of the camera without having to do that. So it's a scene that I will attempt to photograph again on a future trip. And maybe the grasses will be greener, maybe something else will be different about the conditions. So it'll be interesting to see how that scene changes. But it's definitely one that I do want to revisit and see what else I can do with that scene. And finally, we have the two photos that I shot while I was in Capitol Reef. The first one was the vertical photo with those three boulders. It had just kind of finished raining, and it rained a little bit after I shot the photo too, so all the bentonite clay was very well saturated, which was really cool. It was really interesting just walking around that whole area because it was so alive of color. I was just trying to find something interesting to point my camera at. And those boulders really sort of grabbed my attention because it seemed like it was kind of telling a little bit of a story about like erosion and the way that everything was kind of breaking down and things were physically falling down the slopes. And so when I saw the two main boulders, those are the ones I was gonna photograph, but then I really couldn't shoot those without shooting a third one, so I ended up deciding on a vertical composition. But I kind of moved through the scene because there's an area between the biggest boulder and the second biggest boulder where I really wanted to be able to show a little bit of that black edge of the second biggest rock and also have a little bit of a separation between them. So that's kind of where I decided where I was gonna stand because I wanted to have that separation between them and to be able to see the dark edge to sort of separate them a little bit. What was interesting is that the orange area on the right side of the largest boulder there, it almost looks like there's like another sort of light source hitting that. It almost looks like there's some golden light hitting that, which I think is also kind of further enhanced by the fact that there is a little bit of light kind of hitting the right side of the more foreground slope down there. So it almost gives kind of a painterly kind of light to the scene, even though it was just overcast conditions. But it's just a matter of the natural coloring of the rock combined with the fact that Velvia increases the color and the contrast a little bit in a different way than just simply cranking up the saturation in Photoshop. It just kind of reacts differently with some colors than others. The composition, I was just trying to find the right balance between the left side of the biggest rock and then the right side of the smallest rock down the right lower right corner. And also, I was trying to manage the space between the bottom of that smaller rock and the bottom of the frame. So I used a normal lens. I just kind of looked at the scene for a while, kind of studied it, and I didn't think too much about this photo when I shot it. I thought that it might feel really top heavy, really right heavy, and it does, but that also helps to kind of build a little bit of visual tension, which I think is kind of an important part of the storytelling of this particular photo. So this is kind of the sleeper sort of photo where I didn't think too much of it when I was shooting it. It was kind of an exercise of pointing my camera at something. When I saw the film reveal, again, it was kind of I didn't think too much about it, but now that I've been kind of living with it for a while, I think it's actually a pretty strong photo because I have The color contrast, the greens, the reds, and the light colored stones set against all that. The composition is somewhat dynamic because it kind of tells a little bit of the story of the rocks crumbling and kind of falling down. And that foreground slope is kind of interesting with some of the lines and textures and colors and the richness of it. So this actually ends up being one of my favorite photos from the trip, even though I didn't really think too much of it at the moment I was shooting it. And I also didn't think too much about it the moment that I saw the film. But those are the photos that I really do like to look at. And then finally, the last photo I shot on the trip was not far from that vertical photo. It's the horizontal with the green clay, the yellow boulders. And this one was also a little bit of a tricky composition just because immediately out of the bottom of the frame, there is a huge, huge boulder that I really couldn't work into the composition, so I had to completely eliminate it. I still have a good amount of space between that cluster of yellowish rocks in the bottom of the frame, but in a perfect world, I would have loved to have even a little bit more room down there. But you have this strong diagonal sweeping line coming in from the lower left with all those rocks and sort of the grayish soil and some of the bushes. And then you have the more curved line coming in kind of from the upper right. Then the graduation in color from kind of greens up towards some of the more reddish, sort of earthy sort of tones. This one turned out pretty decent. I like the color contrast on it. There's something about the balance that I'm just not as into. I think it has to do with the sort of the line that goes across the kind of somewhat near the top of the frame, where it almost looks like there's a trail or road up there. It's not, it's just something natural, but something about that's kind of thrown me off a little bit. I think if I had an even longer lens, it may have been kind of cool. It's a shot that will definitely be in my portfolio, but I think the previous shot, the vertical one with the three boulders, I think it's a little bit stronger because I think the composition is a little bit more cohesive and there isn't anything in that one I'm looking at and really wishing I had more or less of, or you know, something throwing it off. But overall, it was a very interesting trip. I think I have, really there's three photos in particular I really like from the trip, but there's definitely some room for improvement on some of them. But it's also a canyon I really look forward to revisiting to get to know a little bit more and also spend some more time in Capitol Reef. But this pretty much wraps up the spring trip, and now it'll be kind of a long time until I go on my next trip, which will be to southern Utah again in kind of mid-late October. So I'm looking forward to getting out there. But I'm also looking forward to maybe doing a little more local shooting as well, maybe up in the local mountains. So maybe I'll have some videos from that. But I want to thank everyone for watching, and we'll see you around next time.